Good morning, church. I want to welcome everyone to Lake Shores Church this morning. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. You would stand and worship with us this morning. Forgiven, if only you'd forgive yourself. You've been made new, but you're still standing where you fell. 'Cause when you look in the mirror, seems like all you ever see are the scars of every failure and the you that used to be. So tell your heart to beat again, close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away, step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door, you don't live there anymore. So say goodbye to where you've been, tell your heart to beat again. Forgiven, just let that word wash over you. It's alright now, love's healing hands have pulled you through. So get back up and take step one. Now your new life has begun. Know that if the sun has set you free, you are free. Tell your heart to beat again, close your eyes and breathe it in. Let the shadows fall away, step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door, but you don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been, tell your heart to beat again. Hope is reaching from a rugged cross, where a perfect love recaptured all the innocence that's lost. Mercy's calling from an empty grave. So lift your eyes to heaven, hear your Savior say, tell your heart to beat again. Oh, just breathe it in. 'Cause yesterday's a closing door, but you don't live there anymore. So say goodbye to where you've been. Tell your heart to beat again. Tell tell your heart, beat
All right. Good morning, Lake Shores Church. My name is Corey Scahill. I am a partner here. We just want to welcome you. Thank you for being here on this beautiful Sunday. We'd ask that you would check in on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, whatever your favorite social media app is. I got a few announcements before I get started. Please bow your head and let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for being a great, loving Father. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to get up and to serve in your name on a daily basis. We ask that as you deliver a message to us today, that you would speak to us, that you would speak through us, and in spite of us. And Lord, we just ask that you'd put us in front of somebody who we are uniquely qualified to share your love and grace with. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. All right, a couple quick announcements. We have a baptism after church today. So immediately following this service, if you funnel out to the back, they're going to give us a few minutes of buffer time to pick up your kids in the children's area. So please go get them. Have them come in, join on the great celebration that is the declaration of following after Jesus. So be sure to check that out. Father's Day. It is Father's Day. Shout out to all the dads out there. Yep. Father's Day is easily my favorite made-up holiday. Not because my family's going to wait on me hand and foot throughout the day, but because in our family, we have an added pressure of delivering greeting cards on or before said holidays. So this is the one time a year that that pressure does not land on my shoulders. I don't have to worry about hurrying into HEB only to find that the entire card section has been completely picked through, and I'm stuck with, you know, the last three or four cards. Yeah, that looks like something I would say. $7? Like $7 for a greeting card, right? But really, dads, we're just so thankful for all the lessons you've taught us over the years through your dadisms. Specifically, like, you know, the history ride car lesson, or the history lesson in the car ride. You know, hey, you see that subdivision and development over there? I remember when that was nothing but cow pastures. Or another one, the lesson in fiscal responsibility. Hey, close that sliding glass door. I'm not paying to air condition the entire neighborhood. And last but not least, my favorite, the lesson in the art of the deal. At said checkout register in HEB, when the cashier's ringing you up, boop, 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 picks up the $7 card. Dad leans over. Well, guess it must be free. So, in all seriousness, dads, thank y'all so much. We love you. We appreciate everything you do to help, you know, further your families, the work that you do in the communities, and the things that you're doing to further the kingdom of God. We are just so grateful and so blessed. So, now comes to our favorite time in our church is the clumping. If you're new to Lakeshore's Church, clumping is a time that we spend to get to know our neighbors. John always says it's going to be embarrassing if we get to, the eternal kingdom, and you don't even know the name of the person you've been sitting next to every Sunday at church. They might be a dad, so if they're a dad, or they've had a dad, why don't you just ask them what their favorite dadism is? That's a good icebreaker. So, I believe the clock is going to start. Here we go. All right. Clump on.
Good morning. Good morning and happy Father's Day. Please hold on to the communion elements until I close this in prayer so that we can share in Holy Communion together as a body of Christ. Being Father's Day, I have to share one of my husband's early experiences as a father. Our youngest daughter could be challenging at times if she was that child who sought the hardest to define the boundaries of right and wrong. Just prior to her sister's birthday party, Lucy snuck under the kitchen table, reached up and over the edge of the table and grabbed a corner off of her sister's birthday cake for a little premature tasting. Suddenly, the house seemed all too quiet. Jim and I immediately started looking around for what might be wrong. We saw the cornerless birthday cake on the table, but no Lucy. Jim found Lucy behind her bedroom door with evidence of chocolate smeared across her face. Jim prepared to discipline her. But as he started to paddle her, Lucy started singing, "Jesus loves me, this I know." We never did figure out how to paddle a child singing, "Jesus loves me." I was blessed to have an earthly father that made learning about and believing in a heavenly father easy. My daddy knew how to love, he knew how to give, and he knew how to provide for his family and countless others. My daddy was my first glimpse into a heavenly father. Today, as we remember our own fathers, may we also take time to contemplate on all that it means to call God our Father. For it is vital in our Christian journey to have a true understanding of our heavenly Father. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, we can have an intimate father-child relationship with God. Romans 8:15 teaches us that we have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but we have received a spirit of adoption as sons and daughters by which we cry out, "Abba, Father." Abba is the name Jesus himself used for his father when he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. "Daddy," Jesus prayed, "all things are possible for you." Abba expresses all the love and affection of a small child for his daddy. The great God of the universe invites you and me to call him daddy. We can come to him as little children come to their daddies. As his children, we can crawl into his presence and rest in his grace and mercy. We can find peace and comfort as he wraps his loving arms around us and embraces us with his love. Our heavenly Father knows every hair on our head. He anticipates our every need before we even ask. He gives us every good and perfect gift. Our Heavenly Father has chosen each and every one of us by name. He loves us unconditionally, and he disciplines us so that we might become like his son. Jim attempted to discipline our daughter Lucy after she helped herself to her sister's birthday cake before the party had ever begun. There is no doubt in my mind that Lucy knew she had done something wrong. But she also knew her daddy loved her and would forgive her. No matter what we have done in our lives, no matter how many bad decisions we've made, no matter how much we have sinned, we can be reconciled with our Heavenly Father because he is our daddy and he loves us more than we will ever be able to comprehend. Our daughter Lucy knew the way to her father's heart. She knew she would be forgiven. Because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, we too can sing with joy and confidence, "Jesus loves me, this I know." Let us pray. Almighty God, creator of the universe, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Thank you for our earthly fathers, our parental role models and father figures that we celebrate today. Thank you for paying the ultimate price by sending your precious son to take our place and to bear the punishment for our sins so that we could be adopted into the family of faith and be called your children. Abba, Daddy, you are a good, good father. Thank you for loving us enough to give us the gift of eternal life through your son, Jesus Christ. Let us now celebrate this love through Holy Communion. Amen. Thank you.
So for the most discerning, yes, I spilled coffee down the left side of me during first service. But none of it hit the floor. But they did say I have to have a lid from now on. So that's just the way it goes. Who is Jesus? This week, it is like you can't get around it. There's a decision that has to be made as we come to the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Several of you have wondered if we were going to get to the end of the Sermon on the Mount. And we're on the last verses. We just run out of material after this, right? We only got the next 38 chapters of Matthew to go through. So here we go. But this is amazing. You know, as I thought about today's text and what we'll be talking about, it just brought to my mind this whole idea about how similar life is with and without Jesus. In the United States, it's very similar. And that's the problem. You can have a pretty good life in America and in a lot of other places in the world. You know, it can be pretty good. Basically, there's a few principles that you need to adopt to have a pretty good life. You know, be a law-abiding citizen, pay your taxes, and if you don't drive through HICO, you're pretty much don't get interfered with by the government, right? They'll basically leave you alone, and you can have a pretty good life. Then you add on to that principle some financial wisdom. And I'm talking the basics here, that less has to go out than comes in, right? Now, it takes some people decades to figure that out. Others figure it out as four-year-olds, you know, so it's an amazing concept. But at some point, you know, if you want the pretty good life, you got to realize less goes out than comes in. And once you start doing that, you kind of start, you establish some financial stability. And you kind of get a place. It could be a mobile home, it could be a house, it could be an RV, it could be an apartment, whatever it is, but you kind of get a place. And you get stable, and every once in a while, you can do some nice things for yourself. So, you know, you're law-abiding, you understand the idea about money, and then you come up with some wise sayings. Corey has already shared some of the wisest ones known to man with us this morning, but there are others. At my house, my kids, got over this and through counseling, but one of the wittyisms, one of the wisdom sayings of the Glaser family has always been, and they shudder when they hear me start saying it even today, take care of your equipment, and your equipment will take care of you. That is gospel. That is truth. And in our home, when they'd bellyache, especially when they got cars, I'd go, well, first of all, I don't know anything about a car except you put fluid in it and press a pedal. The one on the right, usually. That's my extent with cars. Tires run out at some point, and they blow up. If they had problems, I said, take care of your equipment. Your equipment takes care of you. And we live by that truth in the Glaser household. And there are other truths out there that all of us have. And do you take that? So you got some truths that you've accepted. You've got some financial stability. You're law-abiding. Then you throw in some family and friends. And you just get a couple of family people that you like. You know, you're extremely blessed if you have two or three family people you like. And then, you know, get a friend or two to kind of throw in with that. And, you know, life's pretty good. Life's pretty good at that point. And that's America for the most part. Life's pretty good. Now, there are going to be misfortunes and tragedies, but you know, you've got your a couple of friends and a couple of family members to kind of help you through, and they'll have wise sayings, you know, and that they'll bring up and say, you know, if you just do these things, it's all good, and we're going to make it together, and it's a pretty good life. And that's the obstacle and struggle we face when we think about trying to teach the world the wisdom of Jesus Christ, because Christian and non-Christian, follower, non-follower, your lives are pretty much the same. They're pretty same. And then you add on top of that like we said, you know, a couple weeks ago, 75% of Americans say that they believe in the Lord and that their faith is important to them. Now, I don't know where that 75% is, but there's 75% out there that say that. So they, you know, a lot of people have heard some words of Jesus, you know, and they've got some great ideas, and they can, in fact, quote parts of the Bible. And one of their favorite quotes is, God helps those who help themselves. Now, see, I told first service that's how it go. First service was on the floor laughing so hard. You know, half of second service has quoted that as Bible. So I know. Well, let me tell you before you, you know, give yourself up here that that's not Bible. You know? But that's one of those sayings, right? And now, there are nuances. I can make that biblical truth, but I got to nuance it about five times to get there. But the general idea, God helps those who help himself, is ungodly and non-gospel and idolatrous Americanism. And I'm not sharing my strong feelings about it yet, right? But that's what they do. So they got all that, right? So they feel pretty righteous. And they got a pretty good life because they follow these principles. It's all good. It's a pretty good life. And that's the problem. A truism, I don't know if it's in the Bible or not. I could probably nuance it somewhere in there. But, you know, good is the greatest enemy of best. And that's what we're fighting. We're fighting a pretty good life for the best life. Because you know what's so good about the pretty good life? I decide. I make all the decisions. Now, I act sometimes like others are making the decision. Sometimes I even act like God's making the decision. But I'm making the decision. And that's a pretty good life. But in the best life, you don't make the decisions. You act from your nature. See, because here's the problem. There is a question that must be resolved. And if you're living the pretty good life, you can push that question off forever and never have to address it. And that question is, how are you going to deal with your estrangement from God the Father? That's the issue of life. It's not my broken foot. It's not my cancer. It's not my children rebelling against my teaching. It's not my lost job. It's not the garage door opener doesn't work. It's, how do I deal with my estrangement from God? And that is the life and death question that each person has a lifetime to answer. And most people do not seek the answer. And that's what's so brilliant about this concluding parable of Jesus Christ. As he talks to us, the very last thing he's going to say after all these great things on the Sermon on the Mount is this: don't settle for the pretty good life. Settle for what is best. But what's the difference? He's going to show us it's not much in one sense, but it's everything in another sense, right? Listen to the parable. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. So if you're wise, you'll want to know what the rock is, right? We'll get to that later. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and then beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. Now here's the irony of the parable. To a casual observer, these houses are great. Both houses are great. They got double front doors. See, I didn't even know a house was supposed to have a double front door until I was 35. One day we were driving down the street, and Hay goes, that's a house with a double front door. And I go, what's a double front door? I'd never seen this. I thought the upgrade was the little window beside the single door, right? I thought I was so proud of that upgrade. But no, there's double doors. And I said, well, what do you do with the other half of the door? You know? And so she told, so these are great looking houses. They got the double door entry. They got the arched, you know, entranceway. They've got rooms and people live in them and they don't fall down and the air conditioning works and they're great. They got driveways and garages and they're beautiful houses. They're pretty good places to be. They look exactly the same, but there's a storm coming. Okay. The storm is not your circumstances and your problems in life. Now, the storm is when Jesus Christ says, hello, I just came back and blew up your world. Now what are you going to do? Now you got to talk to me. There's nothing left. I just blew up the universe. It's just you and me. Let's have a conversation. You and you look a lot alike. You built your life on the rock. You built your life on the sand. Life, death. This is the storm. This is the final moment when the decision is shown and the result is given. So many times in the Christian life, and you know, I got to go off on this every once in a while, right? And we'll come back to it again probably before the lesson's over. But, you know, so many times in Christian life, we keep telling people, hey, become a Christian and your life is great. Not necessarily so. You know, you become a Christian, your life may get worse, depending on where you live in the world, right? And it might get better, then it might get worse. It might not change. Your circumstances, your situation, your life may not even change. But there's still a decision that has to be made. And it's the ultimate decision of where will you stand? On the rock or the sand when everything's taken away and you're standing before God? What will your decision have been? And that's what's the power of this, because Jesus is saying that that foundation are these very words I've told you over the last 15 or 20 minutes. As he's given this Sermon on the Mount. Now, when all of that happens, the point is, am I built on the foundation of wisdom or the foundation of me? And what people understand who are wise is that they listen to the words of Jesus and put them into practice. And in doing so, they have built the foundation that brings salvation. Now hang with me. I know some of you just got anxious. Sit tight. Those who choose to write their own wisdom through a mishmash of wise sounding sayings will have nothing to stand on when the truth is revealed and they will be destroyed. Are we saved by good works? No. We are saved by the grace of God through Jesus Christ. However, true faith exhibits acts of righteousness. You cannot have faith without acts of righteousness. There are no acts of righteousness without faith. Now, in our world, we always want to be black and white, right? It's either or. It's never and. And one of the great ways to understand a God that we can't understand is usually put the word and in. I've found a lot of times, right? Am I saved by grace? Yes. And that is evident by my life. That's what Jesus is saying here. There are people who have the sayings of God upon their walls. There are people who can quote the real Bible. There are people who have heard the wisdom of Jesus Christ, but they have no faith because they have not changed their life. It's evident there's no faith because there's no acts of righteousness. And we've seen that a couple of times in the Sermon on the Mount. Let me just hammer it home with some other passages that echo exactly what Jesus is saying here. 1 John 1 and 6. says, if we claim to have fellowship with him yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. Chapter 2, verses 3 through 6. We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. If you're not, I'll let John say it because he's an authority. John says that the man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar. You cannot say you know Jesus and not do what Jesus asks and teaches and commands. It's not either or, it's and. You believe Jesus and you do what he says. All right. And the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did. Can I do that perfectly? No. But is it my consuming motivation? Yes. My consuming motivation, if I know Jesus, is to walk as he walked. And that shows itself as acts of righteousness in my life. And that is the solid foundation that survives the storm. All right, you with me? You all right? I only had one person attack me after first service. Feel free. Now, here's the question you need to ask. Okay, how do I know that's true? How do I know it's the words that Jesus has said here and nobody else's? The next two verses, which are the throwaway verses, right? Have you ever heard a sermon on the next two verses in Matthew? We always stop the song, you know, build his house upon the sand, build his house upon the... I didn't make you sing it this morning. I was sorely tempted. But, you know, that song, it doesn't do the last two verses after that parable, right? Can you even tell me what the last two verses are in the Sermon on the Mount? Many of us thought it was the parable, right? Look at these last two verses. They are the power. They're the power here. Watch this. When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as their teachers of the law. The crowds. Now, don't put a lot of money on the crowds. We're going to watch them through the rest of Matthew. The crowds are fickle. They love Jesus today. Tomorrow, they don't. This morning, they love him. This afternoon, they don't. The crowds are fickle. But even the crowds who are listening to this Sermon on the Mount realize he's doing something different than all the other teachers. Because see, here's what the teachers did and what we as teachers have to do today. We go to the Wharton, that's a combination of written and spoken. The Wharton, Word of God, and we quote it, and we state it, and we say, God says, and we read from the Bible, right? And then we discern truth, and we kind of give you some ideas about that. So that's why about 50% of my sermons are true, and the other 50% you hear this morning is not. And I hope you hear the right part. But, you know, the authority that I have only comes from God's word. And if I'm outside of God's word, I have no authority. And that's what they were used to. Jesus does something else. And let me give you one more contrast there before I go to there. For this crowd, they had studied the Old Testament, right? And in the Old Testament, what do you constantly hear? The Lord says, the Lord said to me, the Lord appeared to me and said, right? So these prophets were always saying, God spoke these words. I am regurgitating and quoting God's words to you. Jesus comes, and in the Sermon on the Mount, which if this was the whole sermon in itself, takes about 15 or 20 minutes to say out loud, 12 times he says this, but I tell you, that's three, keep count, I tell you, but I tell you, I tell you. Thank you. That in 15 to 20 minutes, and everybody went, even though they will not believe him, they recognized it. This guy is speaking as God. Okay. Who is Jesus? Wacko or God? Because today, when people say they speak as God, I put them in the wacko category, right? And that's where they belong. This guy, I tell you, the real truth, the commandment, do not murder. I tell you that God and I meant by that, do not hate. Do not commit adultery. I tell you, lust is adultery. That blew them away, right? You see all these nuts praying in public and, you know, going on and on, saying all those wonderful, perfect, prayerful, religious phrases. I tell you, God rewards those who pray in secret. I tell you, that's his authority. One guy said, teachers teach by the authority. Jesus speaks with authority. He speaks God's wisdom. New. Explains it deeper. His words, his very words, are salvation. Keep us from destruction. Many people want to claim that, but he's the only one who can get away with it. And so, that's what it boils down to. The question about life, and this estrangement from God, is, do I believe that Jesus is God? Do I believe that he is the Savior? Do I believe him to such a degree that I will consume the Bible? I will consume the Bible so that the Holy Spirit will have the fuel to change my heart. And if I do that, I cannot help but do acts of righteousness. And that's the foundation of rock. Belief, consumption, and action. For those who do not, they will find destruction. And yet we keep going back to right now, it looks almost the same. Right? It looks almost the same. But the decision is for eternity. So, what's that better life? The better life is that your circumstances don't change. The better life is you change and then you treat others with God's love. That's the better life. Those of you who've been doing the Sermon on the Mount praying, you know, it's been amazing. I've received about 12 different people have texted me about it. 4 or 5 more have actually, you know, come up and talked to me personally about it. So at least 20 people have kind of gone through the transition. I think probably more have, just haven't said anything about it. But when you pray those types of things that we've seen in the Sermon on the Mount, what happens? You realize, you know what? That enemy I've hated all these years, I can love. Because that's one of the good gifts God promised, and Jesus promises that God wants to give in the Sermon on the Mount. And if I will pray to love my enemy, I will love my enemy. And that is the better life. Because my enemy may not change, but I've changed. And I've changed my perspective of my enemy. And I am different. It was like the one person who came up to me and said, I started praying that I would love my husband. I thought, oh, this is going to be interesting. I prayed I could start loving my husband because I know. You know, he said, don't divorce and honor and look for reasons to love instead of reasons to leave. And she said, doggone it, he changed me and not my husband. But it's better. It's better because she can love her husband now in new ways. That's the better life. I don't have to be captive to porn. I can pray for God to give me the strength to move away from that. And he will give me that good gift. That's the better life. And all around me, my world may be falling apart. I may have cancer and fleas and everything else. But whatever it is, I'm going to treat everyone around me with the love of God. And that is the best life. We're all going to go through that mess anyway. Why not go through it in the best way possible? By loving everyone around you. By expressing God's love. That's the better life. And you only know that when you experience it. Because all these lives look so much alike. Inside of Christ and outside of Christ. Externally. And that's, man, you know, that's the danger. Let me read a couple. There was an interesting theme in the text that I received around poor in spirit. And one of them admitted, you know, it was the first thing in Matthew chapter 5, so I think everybody read that one. But here's some of the things that people said. You know, I read and learned something illuminating about the first beatitude because blessed are the poor in spirit. I'm realizing it's not my righteousness or virtues because I am truly broken. I need my God and constant devotion to him and his righteousness only. Then in my true poor spirit, I may receive a redeeming gift for me through Christ. I'm given the chance. I'm given the inheritance of the kingdom of God. I surrender, talking about poor in the spirit, I surrender to God's will. And the paragraphs, so all these paragraphs, and I'm reading this part right here. So you're missing all the good stuff. But here is the conclusion. I surrender to God's will and ask for forgiveness because I am confused, frustrated, weak, and exhausted. And someone just said this morning to me sometime during the day already, they said, that is when you can finally hear the wisdom of God. It's when you finally get to the point you go, okay, I'm an idiot. What do I do? In prayer and long pondering, I've come to the conclusion Christ may have chosen poor in the spirit first because without it, we can't have the other blessings. Emptying ourselves from ourselves and allowing Christ to refill us within himself, the Holy Spirit. Again, the whole idea of being poor in the spirit, a surrendered, obedient heart, loving Jesus by following his ways, growing Christ-like characteristics, which is a great summary of this parable of the two houses. So that's the better life right there. That's what Jesus offers us. And my prayer is that we'll understand that's a lot better than the pretty good life that non-believers can scratch out on this universe. Because God loves the just and the unjust. It rains on the just and the unjust. The just and the unjust succeed in business and fail in business. The just and the unjust get sick. The just and the unjust die. But in the end, there's a group of people who die to themselves and live for Christ. And infect the lives of people around them with the love of God. And at night, you can lay your head down on a pillow and hear, well done, good and faithful servant. You can, every night. Well done. Yeah, we took care of that, but well done. Well done. And what a beautiful way to sleep. Well done. Thanks. Because I love you, Father. And I want to reflect you in everything I do. So when the storm comes, I'm with you. And I'm safe. And I live. So here's your homework. Tuesday night on the porch, foundation inspection. So, another great phrase. If you're living by this phrase, you got to get it out of your foundation. And that phrase is, God says, do everything in moderation. That's what the Bible teaches. Does the Bible teach that? I'm going to try to trick you here. No. You know what the Bible says? It says, die completely. Absolutely. Die. Not in moderation. What's dying in moderation? That's like a flopping fish in the bottom of a boat, isn't it? It's trying to die, but it's trying to live. That's just a miserable place to be, right? It's not do everything in moderation. It's whole hog die, all right? So if you got one of those phrases in your foundation, that's straw. And that part of your foundation is cracking, and it's keeping you from enjoying more the better life, right? So look for the straw in your foundation. And I would love, I would cherish, I will even, as the 12 people, I will even respond back. But after the third time you respond to me, I stopped. Right? Some of you saw that. I just stopped. After three times, I'm done. But text me about the straw. I'd love to hear what the straw is. I will not call you out by name. I will not even look at you when I quote you. But I would love to hear what it is in your foundation that you found that you went, oh my goodness, that's screwing up my life. It's just helping me have a pretty good life, and I want the best life. Please let me know what it is. Just fake it and text me, and I'll feel better. Something. Okay? So that's your homework. Let's pray. Father, forgive me for wanting to build my foundation my way. Thank you for the blessing of showing me my stupidity. Thank you for the wisdom of your word so that I can be confident of the foundation on which I stand. Thank you for sending your son and for him to speak as God, to give us the breath of salvation. Let me have confidence and strength, Father, to let you mold my heart through your word and through your spirit, and to follow that heart into the acts of righteousness in front of me. Father, let me know it's all right to mirror your love into the lives of others, because I am not the judge. And in fact, I can't tell the difference in the houses. So let me just focus on showing love. And Lord, thank you for the blessing at the end of each day to know that you're pleased and that there's been learning from the mistakes and there's been blessing from the righteousness. We pray through the power of your son's name. Amen. It's a special thing. We as a group of people are building our lives on the foundation of Jesus Christ. Bless each other, and let's go bless the world around us this week. Go get after it.